Ephesians chapter 3. As you remain in your seats, I certainly want you to follow along Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 through 24. New International Version of the Bible. Actually, I'm going to read the New Living Translation of the Bible, just for brief, which is found on the back of your bulletin. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 through 24, the New Living Translation of the Bible reads like this. The faithful love of the Lord never ends. His mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each and every morning. From that I say to myself, the Lord is my inheritance. Therefore I will hope or put my trust or put my faith or put my dreams or put my realities in his hand. For a few moments, we're going to share from the title, You Can't Keep Me Down. Amen. You cannot keep me down. Some of the most amazing stories in life come from people who appear to be down and completely out. Let me give you a couple of examples. Walt Disney was fired from his job at the Kansas City Star in 1919 because his editor said he didn't have any good ideas. He is known for creating the Disney empire that we know today. He didn't allow one person's words, he didn't allow one situation, he didn't allow one negative occurrence in his life to get him to believe that he would stay down forever, amen? And so he got back up, he continued to do what he loved, and now today kids all over the world are able to enjoy his creation in the Disney movies, in the Disney parks, and in the Disney everything that's going around. Give you another one. Michael Jordan, known as one of the greatest basketball players ever to touch the court, was cut from his high school basketball team. As much as that was a reality in his life, he didn't stay down, amen? But at some point, he continued to practice. He continued to work on his craft. He continued to work on his skills. And now, like I said, he's known as one of the greatest ever to step on the court. And he proved it by not one, but six championships and a number of other great feats and statistics to go along. Got another one. Bill Gates dropped out of business school, graduate school, to start his own company, only to see the company flop, amen. He didn't stay down. He didn't allow that one occurrence or those couple of occurrences in his life to convince him that he was not smart, that he didn't have the ability to think. And now he's one of the creators of one of the companies that we all benefit from, which is Microsoft, amen? If you've ever been on a computer, if you've ever used any kind of computer software, Bill Gates has something within that machine that you're using each and every time you log in. Again, the theme here is recognizing that each and every one of these people had a negative occurrence in their life. They had something that happened that could have shaken their foundation, shaken their core, and shaken their confidence, but they refused to stay down and continue to work and strive to get better each and every day. And now we all know each and every one of them for a great contribution that each of them has made to this country we call the United States of America, and better yet, even the world. When I think of each of these persons and these scenarios, this reminds me of one of my favorite toys when I was younger. And that was the inflatable punching bag, amen, somebody. I love this toy because it allowed me to deal, even at a young age, with frustration that I had. And so if I was mad because my mom got on me for doing my homework or got on me for cleaning up my room, I would spend some time with the inflatable punching bag, just wearing it out, punching it, knocking it, hitting it as hard as I can. And the interesting thing that made this toy so fun was you didn't have to do work to continue playing with it. You would punch it, and it would go down, and it would pop right back up, amen, so that you could punch it again. Now, the thing that made this so fun was when I played basketball, I could shoot and I could make it, but wherever the basketball went, I would have to go again, grab it, come back to where I wanted to, and shoot again. With this toy, I didn't have to do it. I could stay in one place for about an hour, 2 hours, and just have fun wearing this inflatable punching bag out. The thing, no matter how hard you hit it, the thing would continue to pop back up. And one of the things that we loved to do was to tackle it, because we were convinced that we could make this thing stay down. Amen. And so we would tackle it, we would lay on it, we would sit on it, and we would do everything we could, but as soon as we moved, it would pop right back up. So in a way, it was fun, but in a way, it was irritating, because we were trying to get this thing to stay down, but it would continue. No matter what we did, no matter how hard we tried, no matter how many times we hit it, no matter whether we put a table over it or a chair over it to keep it down, every time we came off it or removed it, it would pop right back up. This toy, as well as the reflection of these people that I just mentioned, can teach us as Christians a few things about life and how we can handle the situations that come our way. Even in Bible days, we find someone by the name, a prophet by the name of Jeremiah, who struggled with this, the realities that he was facing, and found a way to continue to keep working and striving to be better for the Lord. The scripture today comes from the book of Lamentations. The root word of Lamentations is the word lament. The word lament means to express sorrow, regret, or unhappiness about something. The book of Lamentations is believed to be written by the prophet Jeremiah, who's also known as the weeping prophet, because he's always whining and crying and fussing about one thing or another. And so he's known, a little trivia, Bible trivia, if you ever get a little Bible trivia, this may come up. Jeremiah is known as the weeping prophet. The book of Lamentations is a collection of things, times, or periods that Jeremiah was sorrowful, regretful, or unhappy about. Jeremiah uses this book to share his sorrow and unhappiness regarding Jerusalem's situation, as well as his very own situation. In chapter 1, we find in the book of Lamentations, Jeremiah talks about Jerusalem's great sin and immorality. One of the repetitive stories that we hear throughout the Old Testament is the failings of God's people, Jerusalem, Israel, whatever you want to term them or whatever you want to call them. So in chapter 1, Jeremiah spends a lot of time lamenting, grieving, and sharing his care and his distaste and his dislike for the sin that is currently in Jerusalem and their great immortality. As we move down to chapter 2, we find that Jeremiah begins to talk about the current physical condition of Jerusalem, because of their sin, because of their immorality, because of their wickedness that they executed for years and years. God allowed a group of enemies to come in and destroy the city. I know some of you are saying, well, it seems like every time we talk about the Old Testament, we're talking about the city of Jerusalem and Judah being destroyed. Well, because it kept happening over and over and over and over again in the Old Testament, we find Jeremiah again in the midst of this time, grieving over his city, grieving over his town, grieving that it seems like nobody is willing to do right. Nobody is willing to stand up for what's right. Nobody is willing to make a stand against those who will sin and continue to allow sin to go on in their city. And so now he stands looking at a destroyed city. Homes are destroyed. Their big palaces are destroyed. The people have been carried away in exile, and Jeremiah is left to weep over his city, weep over his town, to weep over once was a bustling town and city that gave glory and honor to God. Right. And then as we move into chapter 3, we find that Jeremiah begins to talk about his own personal struggles and his own personal suffering. It was in chapter 3 that we find the scripture from this morning. After reflecting on his current suffering that God has allowed in his life, Jeremiah has a moment of reflection regarding the God that he serves. Now, I'm not going to go through all of the suffering and all of the turmoil and struggles that Jeremiah faced. You can kind of do that on your own time. But suffice to say, Jeremiah was dealing with some issues and some turmoil because he, and the way he terms it is, God has fenced me in. He's pinned me up against the wall. He's only allowed me to live and walk in darkness. And this is a reflection of the city he's living in because it's been destroyed. The life that he once knew that was comfortable is now no longer comfortable. The home that he once had that was a place of refuge is now no longer a place of refuge. And Jeremiah is looking for somewhere to turn, looking for somewhere to go, looking as to how he's going to make it through the struggles and the suffering that he's currently going through. And then we come to verse 22. as he's recounting the evil, the horror, the negativity around him, the destruction around him, something brings back to his mind, starting at verse 22. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. Mm. For his compassion never fails.
Yeah.
They are new every morning. Mm. That leads me to say, because of all that great he is, your faithfulness.
Yeah.
I've considered and I'm going to agree and accept that I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. In the face of his current suffering and despair, Jeremiah was able to recall the goodness of the God that he served. In the midst of all this, he acknowledged that God was the only reason that he was still alive to that point. Now, let me stop and say, whatever you're going through, when you're facing difficulty, trials, and challenges in your life, do not forget that the only reason you made it this far is because of God.
Yeah.
We have a tendency when we step upon or come upon or walk upon trouble in our life, we begin to think that our world is over and God has completely forgotten about us. But the reality, if we just step back for 1 second, is the only reason we made it this far is because of God. So why are we going to begin to fret now? Amen. Why are we going to begin to cry now? Why are we going to begin to think that we can't make it now? Because it's God that brought us this far in the first place.
Amen.
An important piece there, Jeremiah, in the midst of his sorrow, in the midst of his crying, in the midst of his weeping, calls back to mind, the only reason I'm alive now, the only reason we're still here is because of God. The next thing that Jeremiah does in the midst of the scripture is he acknowledges that he is flawed and he is lacking. This is major when God revealed to me some of what he was trying to help us to realize. Jeremiah acknowledged, and let me go back to the scripture. He says, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. Why would he need to have compassion if he done everything that God had called him to do? Why would he need to be the recipient of compassion if he done lived his life in a way that acknowledged God each and every day of his life? But what Jeremiah says is, I know I've made some mistakes. I know I've messed up just a little bit. I know I have some issues in my life. So if I'm able to sit and recognize that God is the only reason that I'm alive, and if I'm able to recognize that his compassions never fail, that gives me hope and that encourages me, even though I messed up, God has not left me yet.
Thank you, Lord.
God has not left me yet. He acknowledges that he's flawed. He acknowledges that he's lacking. He acknowledges that in the midst of his crisis, in the midst of the current hell that he's living through, that he needs something to help him along the way, because if he just pays attention to what he sees, he's relegated to throwing the towel and give up. But as he reflects on the God that he serves, he remembers that it was God that brought him that far. And he remembers that God is not one that's going to hold a grudge or be one that's going to punish him forever, but he has mercy and compassion on his own. The next thing that Jeremiah does in the midst of the scripture is he acknowledges that God gives blessings of mercy every single day.
Thank you, Lord.
One of the challenges that we face when we mess up, when we fall down, when we make mistakes is we allow things to carry over from one day to one week to one month, saying, I can't believe I did that. Why did I do that? Why did I allow that to happen? And instead of bearing it in God's hands one day and trying to move on, we replay it over and over and over again in our mind. How could I let this happen? How could I do this? How could I allow myself to slip back into this bad sin? How could I allow myself to do this thing to my children? How could I allow myself to act this way towards my family and my loved ones? How could I allow? And we allow it to tear us up from the inside out because we never allow ourselves to forgive ourselves. But we continue to beat ourselves up and beat ourselves down. And before long, we begin to think that we're no good because we messed up again, because we did it again. The very thing we said we were not going to do, we did again. And so we continue that cycle until we get so low, we don't even want to look up at the sun. We get so low, we don't even want to look at our loved ones. We don't want to look at the ones that care for us and mean the most to us. And so we allow ourselves to wallow in pity. But Jeremiah says, God's mercies are new each and every morning.
Thank you, Lord.
What is mercy? Mercy is holding back or reducing the punishment that you deserve. Amen, somebody.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about you, but I'm so grateful for God's mercy. If it had not been for his mercy, Lord knows I wouldn't be here today. If it had not been for God's mercy, I sure would have been out a long time ago. If it had not been for God's mercy, so Jeremiah acknowledges, I know I've got some issues, I've got some wrong that I've done in my life, but I serve a God that's not only compassionate, but he's merciful. He doesn't hold me every time. He doesn't get on me every time I make a mistake. He doesn't beat me down every time I do it wrong. He doesn't yell at me and fuss at me every time I get it wrong. He has mercy. He's kind with me. He's gentle with me. And he allows his love to encourage me to be better. When I think about this, I can't help but think about me as a parent and how I deal with my children sometimes. There are times when I am not merciful. There are times when I am not compassionate. All I need them to understand is you need to do what I told you to do, how I told you to do it, when I told you to do it, where I told you to do it. But if I forget how merciful God has been to me, then I'll begin to teach my children that when they make mistakes, there's no coming back. And unfortunately, some of us have created a culture in our homes and our families and within our loved ones that if you make one mistake, that's it. I can't deal with you. I'm done with you. But the reality is God has shown mercy and compassion to us time after time after time. And as we come back to Jeremiah, Jeremiah's recognition of that is giving them hope and life and encouragement that he can get up from the situation he's facing at the current moment. As Jeremiah does all this, it results in him looking at his situation in a different way. One of the biggest things that we can do as we face challenges, as we face obstacles, and as we face a mountainous or valley experiences in our life, to see our situation from a different way. Amen. And when we begin to reflect on all that God has done, who God is, and the power that God has, he enables us to see our situation not looking up at the mountain, but looking down on the mountain. Amen, somebody. That's a major difference. Have you ever been in an airplane and have you been flying over the mountains and look out of the window and see just how small the mountains look from that perspective? How would you encounter or come against a challenge against you if it looked that small? You wouldn't think another thing of it. You would step right over it and keep moving. But unfortunately, we are too busy looking at how big the mountain is from our perspective that we allow it to overwhelm us. We allow it to cover us. We allow it to overwhelm us. And we allow it to give us a sense that we cannot overcome this great mountain that sits ahead of us. And the reality is, alone you can. But with God, as the scripture says, you can do all things. As we continue to move through the season of Easter, the reality is Easter was a couple Sundays ago, but we're still in the season of Easter. We don't get out of Easter until we get to Pentecost. But we're still in the season of Easter. Which means we acknowledge that we are moving through a period of resurrection and restoration. That's what Easter is all about. It's all about resurrection, seeing something that was once dead and allowing it or watching it rise back to life again. Or seeing the situation that was fractured, broken, and pulled apart and seeing God put it back together again. That's what this whole season is all about. And if you don't believe me and if you think I'm making it up, just look outside. What happens during this season? The winter months begin to fade. Your plants that were once dead, your yard that was once dead, the flowers that were not blooming are now beginning to sprout and bloom, which is a symbol or a sign of something coming back to life. I don't know about you, but this gives me hope and encouragement for whatever I'm facing in my life, because what it says is, although things are dead today, although it looks like it's gone today, although it feels like I can't win today, tomorrow another day is coming, and if I just stay alive a little bit longer and hold on to God a little bit longer, I might just get to see my situation coming back to life.
Amen.
We're in the season of Easter. Which is a period of restoration and resurrection. Jesus demonstrated in his own body his ability to give his life and to die and then rise again. If there is anything that we should remember in this season, or if there's any one thing that I want you to remember from this sermon, is the fact that we can rise from where we are. Jeremiah's reflection on God enables him to have a mindset of confidence that says, you cannot keep me down.
Amen.
Lord help us. Many of us can relate to Jeremiah because we're going through a period or aspects or elements in our life that has us down.
Amen.
It may be in our finances, it may be in our relationships, it may be with our children, it may be with our health, it may be on our job. No matter what it is, some of us, if not all of us, can relate to Jeremiah. And looking around and everywhere we look around in the midst of our situation, all we see is destruction and death. All we see is relationships torn down. All we see is zero and negatives in the account. All we see is hell coming at us on the job. And we're wondering, is this situation ever going to turn around? Are things ever going to get better in this particular area of my life? I've been dealing with this month after month, week after week, year after year, and nothing seems to get better. Every time it seems like I take a couple steps forward, I turn around and I look back and there's still destruction and death all around us. How am I going to come out of this situation? We may be consumed with darkness and despair all around us. We may be going through a situation in our life where we can't see how we're going to make it. We may be in a situation right now that is keeping us in a state of fear or helplessness. If that's you, I just want you to say these few words. You can't keep me down.
Right.
Let me talk about this a little bit and then we'll be done. I love this phrase because it acknowledges not that we're perfect, it acknowledges that we've fallen. Amen? Amen? Yeah. It acknowledges when you say you can't keep me down, acknowledges that I am down right now. Amen? If I say you can't keep me down, that means that I have to be down in order for you to keep me down. And so when I say you can't keep me down, it first says I'm down, or I'm in a place where I'm down right now at the very current moment. It acknowledges that we are down. It doesn't say why we're down, but it acknowledges that we are down. The next thing that it does is it also acknowledges that there is hope for us to get up from where we are. Amen, somebody. It's very simple. It's like my inflatable punching bag. Amen. It's either up or it's down. But the thing that I love about the inflatable punching bag is it's down for today, but it's not going to be down for long. Amen. As long as the weight comes off, it's popping back up. And I don't know about you, but if you're going through a situation right now, God sent me by to let you know you might be down today. But if you hang on to me, you can get up tomorrow.
Yeah.
If you would simply hold on
to me.
You cannot keep me down. As we look through the Bible, it reminds us of why we have the ability to make the statement, you cannot keep me down. Go through a couple scriptures. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 16. Proverbs chapter 24, 16 says, the godly may trip seven times, but they will get up again.
Amen.
But one disaster is enough to overthrow the wicked. Amen. Which means when you follow God's path, you're going to fall, you're going to trip, you're going to stumble. But you will not stay down because of the God that's living inside of you. But when it comes to a wicked person that has no God inside of them, one trip and then they're gone for good. The 23rd Psalm, amen. Chapter 4 says, even though, and as much as I have it on my paper in NIV, and as much as I see it in NIV, I can't help but I have to say it in the King James. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for God is with me. That lets me know that although I'm going through the valley experience in my life right now, as long as God is with me, I don't have to stay in the valley. I'm simply going through. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31 says, but those who hope in the Lord will renew your strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and they will not faint.
Yes.
Which is to say, it gets hard when you're going through. It gets tiring when you go through. When you're going through your difficult time or your dark time in your life, it takes all of your energy just to keep moving forward. But the scripture reminds us, when we place our hope and trust in the Lord, and when we wait for him to come and bring us through, he is able to give. give us a strength that we have never seen, that allows us to run when we don't feel like run, that allows us to fly when we don't have the ability or the strength to fly. When we wait on the Lord, He will renew our strength. And then the last one, nope, it's not the last one. Ezekiel chapter 37 talks about a valley of dry bones. Amen. It's a deep, dark valley, and the illustration is that there's been a great battle, and a lot of bodies and a lot of people have died in this valley. And the sun has scorched this valley, and all that's left are the bones of those that have fought and died in this valley. Amen. Which is to say, there's a lot of death that has occurred in this valley. There's nothing coming back to life in this valley. Yet, in the scripture, he said, prophet, what do you see? A valley of dry bones. Can these bones live again? He said, well, you know, Lord. He said, prophesy to the bones. And as soon as he began to speak the word of the Lord to what was dead in the valley, it began to come back to life. And the final example that God gave me to remind us that you cannot keep me down is Lazarus. Jesus was in one particular town. Lazarus, one of his good friends, the brother of Mary and Martha, had died. And Mary and Martha sent word to Jesus. Jesus, Lazarus is sick. He's died. I need you to come quickly. The scripture says Jesus waited 2 more days before he would make his journey to see about Lazarus. And as Jesus finally makes his way to Lazarus, they say his body, he'd been dead so long, his body was stinking. Amen. But God, in his infinite wisdom, Jesus, in his all-powerful being, says, Lazarus, come forth. And what do we see? Lazarus still bound in the tape that had him bound as he was dead in his tomb. He comes out of the tomb, and Jesus says, loose that man and let him go. What once was dead is now alive because the word of God went forward. Amen, somebody. So no matter what it is that you're facing in your reality, begin to tell yourself, you can't keep me down. You may be out of a job right now, but I want you to say, you can't keep me down. You may be experiencing strain and separation in your relationship, but remember and utter in your heart, you cannot keep me down. You may have received a negative report from the doctor, but remind yourself, you cannot keep me down. This reminds me of an old children's story. The little engine that could, amen. When we think back to the story about the little engine that could, what we know is the engine was small, they're at the train depot, and the conductor is looking for an engine that can haul this heavy load. The conductor goes to the first engine, who was built to haul heavy loads, and says, can you take this load up the hill and down the hill? And the first engine says, no, I can't do that. It's too big. The load is too heavy. Although I was made to pull a heavy load, I can't handle this heavy load. I can't pull it over the hill. He goes to another engine and says, can you pull this heavy load over the hill? And as he continues to go down the line, everybody's making excuses as to why they cannot pull the load over the hill. And he comes to the little engine, amen, and he asks him the same question. Can you pull this heavy load over the hill? And his response is, I think I can. Amen. And so as they begin to hook the little engine up to the load, he continues to tell himself, I think I can. I think I can. As he begins to pull off from the depot, headed for the hill, he continues to reaffirm to himself, I think I can. I think I can. As he begins to go up the hill, the strain and the load bearing down on the little engine, getting a little heavier, saying, I think I can. I think I can. He gets a little bit closer to the top, but yet still struggling and reaffirming to himself, I think I can. I think I can. And when he gets to the top, amen, and begins to head down the other side, he doesn't say, I think I can. He said, I thought I could. I thought I could. I'm just here to let somebody know and encourage somebody, whatever it is you're facing, whatever challenges you are that are coming your way, continue to reaffirm in your mind and say, you can't keep me down. You can't keep me down. And you can add to it, I believe God can. I believe God can. I believe God can. And when God brings you on the other side of your issue, celebrate and say, I knew he could. I knew he could. I'm what you're going through, but I need somebody to remember, no matter what you're facing, tell it to his face. You can't keep me down. And the reason that you can say that is not because of you, amen, not because of your heart and not because of your engine, but because of the God that you serve. When Jeremiah was faced with his difficulty, with his problem, and with his suffering, he didn't recall his own inner strength, but he recalled the strength of the God that he served. And it says, the faithful love of the Lord never ends. His mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning. Because I reflect on all that I know about God, because I reflect on what I know God is capable of, it leads me to say, the Lord is my inheritance. Therefore, I will wait, I will hope, I will trust, I will put my faith in him. Whatever the mountain is in your life, whatever the challenge is in your life, remember the God that you serve. Remember what he's capable of doing. Remember what he's already demonstrated in the past. And then reaffirm yourself by saying, although it looks dangerous, I will trust in the Lord. Although it looks impossible, I will put my faith and trust in God. Although people are telling me there's no hope, I will continue to put my trust in the Lord. Why? Because God is great in his faithfulness. So faithful that he will continue to love us in spite of ourselves. But his faithfulness is not just to bring us through bad times. His faithfulness is not just to give us exactly what we want. His faithfulness is not just to allow us to be able to breathe a sigh of relief when we go through difficulty. His faithfulness is to demonstrate his power and his ability to change your situation in such a way that other people see you and say, how can I have what you've got? And when they come to you, you can say, it's only because of the Lord on my side. You can't keep me down because God is on my side. If you need any other example to demonstrate how this is possible, look a couple of weeks ago at Jesus. Amen, somebody. He was hung and nailed to the cross. Amen. He was called everything but a child of God. He was beaten. He was whipped. He had blood pouring out of his body. It seemed, and it doesn't seem, it was that the whole world was against him. None of the people that he healed came to his aid. None of the people that he did miracles for came to his aid. None of the people that he brought back to life came to his aid. None of the people that he gave his very life for came to his aid. So he was on the cross all by himself, and it got so bad that the very Father, the God of heaven and earth, couldn't even stand to look at his son, so that at 12 in the afternoon, it became dark as night, because his heavenly Father, God, could not stand to look at sin that had been placed on his son's back. But in the midst of it all, when they thought they had him, amen, when they thought they had him down for the very last count, he gave his life, amen, and the Roman soldiers began to rejoice, but the clouds began to come in, and the lightning began to flash. Ultimately, when it comes to the very next day, but 3 days later, early Sunday morning, they went to the tomb and his body was not there, which is to say, Jesus had the last say by saying, although you whipped me, although you beat me, although you nailed me to a cross, although you placed me in the tomb, you cannot keep me down, because my destiny is not in your hands, but it is in the hands of God the Father Almighty. God specializes in bringing back to life those things that appear to be dead. God specializes in bringing back together things that appear to be destroyed. You have to make up in your mind that you're going to trust God and let your situation know, you can't keep me down.
All right.
Before I finish, to my young people, I need you to hear me. Because so many of, a lot of times what I say when I get all excited goes right over young people's heads and they might catch a little bit of it. But the thing that I need them to understand is troubles and challenges will come your way in life. And this is one of the reasons why I love sports. Because it helps them to go through experiences that shows them that things won't always go their way. These two young ladies that play soccer, they were on a team that lost maybe two or three games all of last year, amen, that came after a season where they only won one game in an entire spring and fall, amen? But the reality is they kept playing, they kept fighting, they didn't give up, they continued to study, they continued to learn, they continued to practice, they continued to give their best, and they received a wonderful reward last year by coming in second place in their league. Now we move forward to this season. They had a lot of great expectations, but things aren't really going the way they anticipated. But the way these two young ladies played yesterday, I have to commend Kennedy. There was one particular play, she had the ball, she was going towards the goal, she had two defenders on her, they were pulling and tugging at her, she kept fighting, she kicked the ball, she got knocked over, fell on her ribs, she injured herself, but she kept on going, which is the very spirit that God is trying to show us. You may knock me down, but you cannot keep me down. And so she had to go out of the game because she was injured for a while, but a little bit later she came right back, and she was back on the field to give her very best. The difference a lot of times between you reaching your dreams and missing your dreams is your determination to stay down or get back up, amen? It's really that simple. A lot of times, something bad happens and we say, well, why would this happen? Well, if this negative thing happened, then it must not be meant for me. I must not be meant to have this dream, so I'm just going to give up. But the reality is, when God has placed something in your heart, when you have a love and a passion for something so much that you want it so bad, you've got to allow nothing to stop you.
Yeah.
There will be people who will try and stop you. There will be people who will tell you you cannot. There will be people who will come and say you're not cut out for it. But if it's in you, and if you have a heart to do it, and if you have the will and the ability to work at it, you can achieve each and every one of your dreams and goals that you have in your life. Whether in school, whether at home, whether in your future, whatever it is, you are unstoppable. When you follow the path of God for your life, you just have to remember, when the trouble comes, when the haters come, when those that talk about you come, you can think, you don't have to say it with your mouth, but you can think in your mind, you cannot stop me. You cannot keep me down. You cannot prevent me from getting where I desire to go. Mm-hmm. And if we continue to keep that mindset, there will be trouble that will come, but you will find yourself being able to move through, above, and beyond the troubles. Because you've got something a little stronger inside of you, pushing you forward and helping you along. I'm done. I'm finished. That's all I've got to say. But I want to say it one last time. You can't keep me down. Amen? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise for his word.